Well, good morning, everybody. I'm Beth Caldwell. It is Friday, July the 6th at 10 a.m. Eastern Time. We're here this morning for Empowered Productivity. And I have a lot of people on the line this morning to learn some productivity strategies. You know, I am never surprised. This class is always so well attended. It seems like everybody wants to learn how to be able to get more done in less time and how to just do more, more, more. And I can't wait to share with you some of the strategies that I've learned, but I'll give you a warning. I'm not gonna teach you how to do more today. I'm gonna teach you how to do less. Does that sound scary? But get more accomplished. So there's the caveat. Let me go ahead and share my screen with you. I am going to give a presentation now, and let's see here. Give me 1 second. Okay. I'm going to give a presentation now, and if you have questions that come up or thoughts that come up, or if you have any ideas or aha moments, go ahead and put them into the chat box. Now, I can't see the chat box right now while I'm giving the presentation, but when I'm done, I'll come back and answer your questions. I don't intend to take up an entire hour of your time this morning. I'm gonna try to get this done in about 40 minutes. But once the workshop is over, I'll stay here as long as you need me to answer questions for you. So one thing that I do wanna tell you is you are going to want to have a pen and paper, or your favorite way to take notes. If you're ready to settle in and learn, I would suggest you turn off your phone. My phone right now is buzzing. I'm sure it's somebody telling me they're having trouble getting on the webinar, and I'm gonna trust that they will figure it out on their own because I'm here with you now. And you'll wanna grab a pen and paper, your favorite way to take notes, and a drink. Shut off your phone if you can. Make this webinar in full screen so you're not seeing your other alerts, and just give yourself this gift to learn a little bit about how you can be a better you, okay? As a speaker, I always have a hot drink and a cold drink because you never know which way your voice is gonna go. All right, so welcome to Empowered Productivity. 7 strategies to help you master that crazy to-do list and get more accomplished. I'm gonna change that word on the slide to get more done. I'm gonna say get more accomplished and more important work accomplished with clarity, confidence, and contentment. So I wanna warn you, I'm gonna give you a disclaimer right from the beginning. If you stay for this workshop all the way to the end, and if you implement some of the strategies that I share with you, you may experience some unfamiliar, peaceful feelings. Just letting you know, your productivity may accelerate. For those of you who have known me personally, sometimes people are saying, Beth, I see you everywhere. You're just doing everything. Well, you know, that's kind of a compliment because I've been for years in the public relations and marketing field. So I'm glad people are seeing what I put out there. But the truth is, I don't do any more than any of you do. My work is just more visible. You do a lot, maybe even more than I do. You have as much energy as I do, maybe possibly more. You are very productive. You might be a little bit scattered. You might be a little bit stuck, but you can get as much done as I do, and you don't have to put it as public as I do, but don't think that I'm different just because I'm more visible, okay? So I wanna put up a picture here of a formerly frantic lady. And some of you have seen this photo before. This is a picture of me and my sons, Brian and Kevin. This was shortly after I began my entrepreneurial career here in my hometown of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. I had a magazine called the Pittsburgh Kids Directory. Before that, I was a social worker. And in the social work field, they, oh, I just thought of something. That may be where I learned to be frantic in the social work field, right? Where we kind of sort of try to juggle everything and do so much more than is humanly possible in a day at that job. I was a former social worker. They wouldn't let me change the world. They had too many rules. And so I became an entrepreneur. I started my own business. It was a little magazine called the Pittsburgh Kids Directory. I also had a little companion magazine that went to that called the Pittsburgh Wedding Directory. And I was a publisher back when print publishing was cool, still before the internet was really hot. And so I had a very visible career. I was visible in my community. I was visible in the kids' school. I was visible in church. And I went to JCPenney and had this picture taken with my boys for my magazine. And from when people would open up that little magazine and read my column every month, I give them tips and strategies very much like I do now on the internet. And I think people thought, wow, she's really successful. And I don't want to demean my success. I was very successful. I had a lot. I'd accomplished a lot despite a divorce, despite a child with health issues. But what you don't see in this picture is that woman in the picture, who was also wearing a silver necklace, interesting, and a kind of blue-purple top, sort of my thing. That woman was really tired. That woman was on the verge of being very, very sick. That woman didn't sleep every night. Seriously, I did not sleep every night. Two nights a week, I would not go to bed so that I could get all my work done because I said yes to everything. And I was the person you could count on. So not only was I doing my work, but I was also doing, you know, the Boy Scouts work and the softball team's work and the swimming team and the church and the Girl Scouts. And I don't have a girl, but I was on the Girl Scout thing at church, right? I said yes to everything. I was on committees. I was with the on the board for National Association of Women Business Owners. I was just doing. And what happened would be when it came to my clients and doing the work and what I was paid to do, I was doing that after 10 p.m. because I was doing everybody else's work. So even though things look a certain way from the outside, it might not be the way it really is. So that's a formerly frantic lady. Now here's what happened. I became seriously ill, which is what happens when you abuse your body by not allowing yourself to sleep, not allowing yourself to eat well, not allowing yourself to take any time to rest or recover, and constantly overbooking yourself. I did not eat well. I did not take great care of myself. Became seriously ill, very seriously ill. My illness was pneumonia. I started with a little tickle in my throat in February. It turned into a cough. It turned into bronchitis. And in March, I wound up in the hospital with really serious pneumonia. When I came home from the hospital, you guys, I was 37 years old, two kids, not driving age yet. I had a visiting nurse coming to the home to take care of me. I had gone from this vital, energetic, enthusiastic, people called me the Energizer Bunny, to somebody who never stopped, from somebody who never stopped to somebody who could not get up off the couch. Now, I was a helper. And I found myself in a place of having to ask for help. I had to ask my friends, my church member friends, my cousins, my grandmother came in the morning and took Kevin and put him on the school bus. It was really hard for me. And when I was laying on that couch, I had this realization that if I didn't change, these kids may not have a mother. I mean, I was really sick and it was frightening. So I got an invitation to go to a coaching session. It was sort of like a coaching party, kind of like a Pampered Chef party that one of my friends was having down the street. On a Friday afternoon, she had a coach come in and the coach was going to practice coaching on us. Now, I knew a little bit about coaching, but I'd never hired a coach at that point. And after what I had been through, I was ready to make some changes. So we sat on my friend Joyce's front porch and there were about six of us and the coach went around and she told us what she did. And she said, now what I'd like to do is I would like to fix some problems. So tell me what your problems are. And then she looked at me because I think everybody planned ahead. They were going to work on me, right? Because I was the one who was a hot mess. And she looked at me and I reluctantly said, yeah, like my life is a disaster. I mean, I'm so frantic and so busy and so insanely overwhelmed. And guess what? I had money. My business was doing well, but I didn't have any savings. the money would come in and it would go back out again. It just came in and the bills would come. And if there was an emergency, I had to charge it. I had a couple of maybe a few thousand dollars of savings, but I didn't have anything significant to where if something serious happened to me again, I was going to be where we were going to be able to handle it. So I was worried about that because being off work sick for 2 months blew through my entire savings. So the coach just couldn't wait to get her hands on me, right? And so she took me through this visualization. And this is, I giggle because it's actually very funny. This is her, the coach's name was Pat. And I know this was probably, if she remembers it, a disappointing moment for her, but it was seriously one of the most important and pivotal moments in my life, okay? So imagine, it's a beautiful June afternoon, we're sitting on my friend's porch, everybody has a glass of iced tea or lemonade, and Pat, the coach, is taking me through visualization. Now, Pat, as a coach, as a person, as a human, just a tremendously successful person. She had a franchise, she had a great business, she's a tremendous athlete, very successful. She was a very, and is a very diligent, organized, very together person. She has systems. She has structure, everything that I don't have. And so she's sitting here going, look, I can teach you how to like take this mess and systemize it. And I thought, that's what I need. So I jump into this and she takes me through this visualization and she says to me, now I want you to imagine that you go to bed every night at 10 p.m. and you wake up at 6 a.m. and you're alert and you're rested and you're refreshed. And I want you to imagine that your desk is neat and clean. And I want you to imagine that you have 3 healthy, nutritious meals prepared for you and your children every single day. And I want you to imagine, and as she started painting this picture for me, I started thinking, yeah, I don't think so. And everybody on the porch was like, yes, this is what we want for you, Beth. We want some structure. You're just chaotic. And so after she finished the meditation, the visualization, she said to me, how does that feel? And I said, I think I would hate that. And that wasn't what she was expecting. But it was so important because what I realized is that I didn't need or want to change into a different person. What I needed to do was control my chaos a little bit. I enjoy living somewhat impulsively. I enjoy not having structure. In fact, I thrive when I don't have structure. I love to be creative, but I love to be able to do whatever I want. I don't want to know exactly what I'm eating and prepare it on Sunday night and have it all structured out for the whole week. Now, some of you do that. Well, probably nobody here does that because you wouldn't be on this class if that's the way you were. But a lot of people do that and there's nothing wrong with that. It works really well for them. But I don't have to be like that. And so that's where my biggest problem was me thinking, I have to change. I'm not good enough. This doesn't work. You should, you need to stop, you need to start, blah, 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 the stuff in my head, constantly beating myself up. When all I really needed to do was bring some order into this, learn how to say no, get some structure, but not be completely structured. So that little coaching session really helped me pivot to stop trying to change myself to being somebody else and begin to embrace who I am, what I love, and set up some realistic boundaries. So if you resonate with any of that, I'm going to share with you the strategies that I implemented over the next few years. And here's what happened. We went from a person having one little entrepreneurial venture in my hometown of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, to 7 published books. Probably the most important thing I've ever done in my life, creating the Leadership Academy for Women. A wonderful article opportunity to write a print article for Smart Business Magazine. A regular column for the Pittsburgh Business Times. I write for them early then, 2013, I wrote for them pretty often. And now I write for them once a year. Every year on New Year's Day, I have an article that goes out for the new year. And a channel with Pittsburgh Biz TV shows, maybe some of you have seen my leadership channel. I was very fortunate in 2011 to open on stage for Susie Orman for my book, Get Paid What You're Worth. And for the past 4 years, I've been blessed to work with Steve Harvey in his Act Like a Success Institute and been able to meet entrepreneurs all around the world from all walks of life. Has some very fun experiences backstage with some of the great people that he brings to his conferences. So how did that happen? I started doing less and I began to experience more. So that's what I want to share with you today. Now, one of the things that I am also very proud that I accomplished is just last week, I took these six ladies to a Right Away weekend retreat at the beautiful Oak Lodge in Ligonier, Pennsylvania. So that's something that is just a brand new accomplishment, a Right Away weekend. I'm always asked, how do I write a book? How do I write a blog? How do I write an email newsletter? So we went away with these amazing ladies and we did a Right Away weekend. You don't see a picture of Paul there. He was taking the picture, my significant other, but he was our sort of escort, cook, chauffeur, and handyman. And I do want to show you, since I had shown you the picture, these are my boys today, Brian and Kevin. Kevin's about to go into his senior year of college at Bethany College, and Brian attended Penn State, lived in the Caribbean for a couple of years doing really cool things, started his own business, taught soccer to little kids in the Caribbean, and now he's back home in Pittsburgh, and he has a wonderful job with a company called Discover Praxis. He is on their marketing and mentoring team. So everything turned out great there. So let me go ahead and take you back to that time when I was sick and I came home from that coaching session and I sat on my couch and I thought, what am I gonna do about this mess that I've created? You know, I can't get sick like this again. And how am I going to fix this? So the first thing that happened was before I got sick, I was really, really proud of something, and that was my date book. I used to love it. It's a little bit sick now to think about it, but I used to love it when I would open up my date book. You know, I'd be meeting with somebody at a networking event or a coffee, and I'd say, okay, so you want to get together? And at the time, I was doing publicity and marketing consulting for people. Let me see when I can set up an appointment for you, and I'd open up my calendar. And there were so many things on my calendar that 100% of the time, people would go, oh, that's your calendar? And I was very proud. Like, yes, there it is. Now, let me see if I can find, I'm in my head, I'm looking for some white space to fit them in and squeeze them in. And at that time, because my calendar was so full, I would squeeze them in 7 p.m., 7 a.m., Saturdays, Sundays, whatever, worked for them. Could we do a phone call at 6 a.m.? That's really the only time I have. Don't do that. But what happened was when I was sick and I couldn't work, my calendar became completely white. I could not do anything. It was just wiped out. I had friends and family calling people to tell them I couldn't make it. Email was around, that wasn't that long ago. I sent emails to people and just said, I'm sick. I'll call you as soon as I can get back. So for the first time in as long as I can remember, I had a completely empty date book. The slate was clear for me. So I was starting over. And what I had was in my head, all of the things that I needed to do. I had to get back with my clients. I had publishing deadlines. I had graphic designers that were doing things for my magazine. I had things that I knew I needed to do. I mean, on top of the whole return books to the library, pick up the dry cleaning, cook, buy food, those just regular, do laundry, pay the bills for, pay tuition, pay the bills, those kind of things. So all these things were in my head. And so what I did was I started with just a legal pad and I made my to-do list. And I don't know about you, but I have never, you know, people, the time management experts say, you know, make a six most important things to-do lists. And I agree with that completely. And I do that. I try to do only four very important things a day. But I've never had a real to-do list that was less than 20 or 30 things, right? Like being realistic here. So this is from my book, From Frantic to Focused. This is the lady, that's just a picture of her from the book cover. This book just came out last year. And this list, when you open it up, it's a little bit bigger. And this was the actual list that was in my purse when I met with my graphic artist to design this book cover. So that's the actual list, and you'll see on there, if you can see it, it says give, like the fourth thing down. It says, JJ, who's my kitty, give JJ a bath. And then under that, it says, call mom. So we had this blown up into a poster for the book signing. And I was like, really? You give the cat a bath before you call me? But look, that was my brain dump. It was everything I needed to remember. And I wrote it all down first. So that's my first tip for you, is to clear everything out of your head and put it down onto one list. Now, we're going to separate it later. Don't edit yourself or try to organize yourself while you're doing a brain dump. Clearing out your brain clutter is something that you just want to do without interruption. I'm thinking of that Harry Potter scene. If you guys remember what that's called when they stick their head into that, it's exactly what you're doing. You're going to write down everything without editing or organizing yourself. When you're doing your brain dump, you don't want to go away and do something else. Just come back. Now, this may take you more than, 15 minutes. You might sit down for 5 or 10 minutes and write down everything you can think of and then go and do something, and something else will come to your mind. Yes, there's something else I forgot. Oh, one thing on my list that I need to do, I want to change my business insurance. Okay, so like that's something that I need to do. I don't need to do it today, but I do want to get it done. I want to get it on my list. So put it down on this major list. Do a brain clear. A couple of ways I do that. Like I said, I use a legal pad, which is how I started this particular time. Sometimes when I want to do a really big project, I have these big sticky notes that I use right here on my desk. These big sticky notes, and of course I like them in pink, right? But these peel off. You can just get these at Staples or on Amazon. And I'll start with it on my desk, and I'll begin to write my lists. And then if it's for a certain project, I'll put it up on the wall. And every time I think of something, I will put it on that paper. Now, once I have that paper full, I do transfer this to my electronic device. But step number one is to empty out that brain, everything on paper. So step number two, this is when you want to begin to categorize things. So put things in organized files. So for me, this is, I had Dan, my graphic artist, make this image for us. This is pretty much what my pile looks like when I get organized. It's things I need to do, papers or electronic papers, records that I need to file. That's where my clutter comes from. Things that I either need or want to read. I enjoy reading. So what I need to read or review, people I need to call, and things that I don't need to do, but they need to get done. That's my pile of lists. Depending on what you do in your world, your categories may be different. Like you might be building a house right now, so or buying a house. So yours might be house, right? It could just be house stuff. You might have a kid in school now. I don't anymore. So it might be, school papers or school to-dos, things like that. Whatever categories make sense for you right now, step number two is to put all of the items that you put on your brain dump into a category. Now, I know some of you are already trying to get ahead of me. Don't get ahead of me. It's one step at a time. So step number one is list them. Step number two is put them in categories. Step number three is where the rubber really meets the road here when it comes to productivity. So there's a difference between being a very organized person and a very productive person. I know a lot of very organized people. I know very few productive people. And this is where the magic happens. If you want to shift from being organized to productive, what you're going to do is, and what many people do at this time, is they separate things into their categories. And they then begin to do the easiest, the less threatening, the least important things first. And I've done that myself. And a lot of times you'll do the thing that's the most favorite thing to do. Who wouldn't want to do that? That's the way we're humans. We're designed to seek pleasure. But you have to get priorities in straight here if you want to be very productive. I know some of you who are watching today, who are tuned in today, or who are planning to watch the recording, I know some of you work for companies that you want promotions. You want to be recognized for the next promotion. Some of you own businesses and you want to reach new goals. You want to hire people. You want to have higher sales. Some of you want to start businesses, Some of you want to start nonprofits. These things don't happen unless you get clear about your priorities. And it's time to be clear and times to get a little bit tough with yourself on what's important. For me, I had to get really sick to get tough with myself on what's most important. And I'll be honest with you, I'm going to be a little bit vulnerable here. I don't think I was aware of it at the time, but I think what was reflecting and what was important to me was what other people thought of me. Oh, they think Beth is really, really effective and efficient, and they want her to be on this committee. They want her to run this project because they think she is whatever they think. I was really needing that sort of outside reinforcement. And that's why I stuck to doing all that people pleasing. And that people pleasing was not taking care of my family. It wasn't paying my bills. It was making me feel good. It was making me feel needed and feel important. But that I needed the sickness gave me the clarity to know that should not be the priority. Okay. So the important questions that you want to ask yourself after you have your items and categories are, which of these items are income producing? Or if you work for a company now, which are income producing for my company? So sure, if you have a big mess of files, if you work for a company and it's all disorganized and clients from 6 years ago haven't been put in files, that's probably important that you get that done. But if you have 33 people over here that need to be called back for customer service, that's more important for the company today than putting away that old stuff from 6 years ago. So what are income producing activities? And what are my buffering activities? So when you're doing important work in the world, and you are doing important work in the world, fear kicks in. Insecurity, doubt will kick in. And what happens is our brain is going to start tempting you with things called buffering activities, which are things to keep you a buffer between what you're supposed to do and what you really are afraid of doing, okay? And so a buffering activity could be, for me, it's maybe going to lunch with a friend, two and a half hour lunch with a friend. It might be having a party. It might be rescuing a charity, throwing some kind of a fundraiser, something that will keep me busy and too busy to do this project over here. It could be things like binge watching TV, like Netflix. I know when this book came out, when I was working on this book, suddenly I was like, hey, you know, I remember in the 1990s, there was this TV show called Charmed, and it looked really cool, and I never got to see it. So I think I'm just going to watch it now instead of doing my writing, right? Because this was a personal book, and I was putting my personal activities, my story that I'm sharing with you about being sick is in this book. Prior to this book, all of my books were about business and about you and about how you could be successful. So I was feeling pretty awkward about telling this story and putting it out there. And so I started to buffer. Some other activities that I do to buffer, by the way, I did watch all 8 seasons of Charmed, but after the first season, I said, okay, I'll continue this after I write my book because I really did like that show. And I did not see it at all in the 90s. So being aware, recognizing your buffering activities, I'm not saying you can't do that, but how about if I watch one show on Netflix and then I'll finish writing, okay? Or some other activities that I do would be like, I'll say, you know, I haven't cleaned the basement for a while, or I really need to wash all the curtains in the house and all the bedspreads and all the rugs, right? Anything that's going to take me a lot of project. I need to sweep the floors. Oh, I need to sweep the porch. I need to call my friend from high school. These kind of things are buffering activities. And oh, for some people, it's eating, sleeping, drinking. I mean, for everybody, it's different. But paying attention to what you tend to do when you get a little bit nervous, okay? So when you're looking at that list, and one of the things on the list says clean the basement, and you go, yeah, I'm going to do that first. Pay attention to what are the income-producing activities and what really should be done first, and that's how you prioritize them. So what are the requirements? What do you have to do? And what are your time wasters? at this point, when you identify your time wasters, you're going to choose some tasks to delegate. Now, I do talk a whole chapter in my book on delegation. And what I want to tell you is, please lean in and listen to me when I say this. When you're doing things at work and at home that other people can and should do, you're keeping them from learning. You're keeping them from growing. You're keeping them from moving into leadership. You're keeping them from moving into independence. So let's say, for example, there's a report at work that it's really not a part of your job. You've left that part years ago, but you're really good at it. You're really fast at it. You know how to do it. So you keep doing it because you just do it faster and better than everybody else. Well, there was a time when you came to work that you did not know how to do that report. You had to learn how to do it. And by you not letting somebody else do it, first of all, you're keeping yourself back because there's more important things that you could be doing, and you're keeping them from moving forward. So you have to really get clear about what to let go, and you have to really let go of your perfectionism tendencies, especially those of you who are watching today. I don't have time to go into a story about this today. But if those of you who are really particular about, like, at home, the way your towels are folded in the drawer or the way the dishes go in the dishwasher, you have to let go of some of that stuff if you want to be a more productive person. Now, if you're totally fine never really changing from where you are, then focus on the towels and the silverware and the reports being perfect. But those are things that really at the end, nobody's going to remember. Nobody's ever going to say, oh, man, that lady could really fold a towel. Right? So it's time to get very clear about your priorities and what you can let go of, what you can delegate. And so important, when you see this overwhelming list and this overwhelming pile of categories, we really need to remember to show appreciation and gratitude for what we're blessed to have. Some people would do anything to trade problems with us. So we are very blessed as American women that we can have careers, that we can have our own bank accounts, that we have our independence, that we have the rights and the opportunity to have a business or move as high up in our career as we want to. So many of our global sisters do not have that opportunity. And really, how big is that problem, right? How big is that problem? Like, oh, my kid has a dentist appointment and I have a nail appointment. Like, that's a great problem to have, right? So remember to be grateful for our overwhelming to-do list, if that makes any sense to you, but I think it does. Okay, so step number four, now that we have this list, this was key for me because when I was getting my lists together and they were pretty big and pretty overwhelming and I didn't feel well and I was tired, it was hard for me to keep up with that list. And I would tend to look at that list and notice what I didn't get done instead of focusing on what I did get done. So a way to eliminate that kind of head trash is to simply take the items off of your categories and put them right into your calendar. And for this, I did then and I still do today, use an electronic calendar. And this is a part of the learning where I did get some great clarity on what's really important to do now. So here's a great example. I had an idea to write an article because I was traveling around the country with my last book, Smart Leadership. And I was traveling around the country and I was doing a lot of business, the American City Business Journals, which is what the Pittsburgh Business Times is. I was doing a lot of meetings with them and I was meeting these people who worked in offices. And I was just hearing the same problems over and over and over again. And I kept answering the same questions over and over again. I thought to myself, I'm going to do a New Year's article on that because it's the same theme. Well, I had the idea and I was really busy that year. I think Brian was a freshman in college that year. And the new year came and went and I didn't do it. It was still on my to-do list. So I was going over my to-do list in January and I was like, that's still a really good idea. I put that to-do list with, it had, you know, several ideas of tips to write an article on, things to do for the new year. It was January. I put that on my calendar, my electronic calendar for the following Thanksgiving, because I know that in my business, I have a really slow time between Thanksgiving and Christmas. Not a lot of people are doing business strategy or publicity at that time. So Thanksgiving weekend, that popped up on my calendar, and I was too busy to work on it. But I moved it to the first week of December. Then I wrote the article in the first week of December. I sent it to my editor the second week of December. And then that year, it was 13 things to do for your business in 2013. That was the number one most clicked on article that year. And it was in my to-do list for like 13 months. So you don't have to put everything on the calendar for tomorrow, is what I'm trying to tell you. So what you want to do is you want to take everything that's on your calendar and put it in a realistic time. And when you're putting things on your calendar, I want you to be very discerning. Would you put, I'm just going to pull a number, 12, 15, 22 things on a to-do list of your assistants or your coworker? No, we wouldn't do that and expect them to get all of those things done in one afternoon. But we do that to ourselves all the time. So the first thing I want you to do is to be realistic about when you put things in and just knowing that you are going to get it done. But then it's not in your face all the time and giving you anxiety. And the second thing that you want to do after you get that done is you want to think about all the annoying little tasks that pile up and pile up and pile up and you never get to. Now, this might be different for you, but for me, it's meal planning and cooking because I travel so much. And the worst part for me is when I've been on the road, you know, for 8-10 days and I come home and there's nothing in the fridge. And it's like, I'm too tired to go shopping. That's something that I really struggled with. Another thing for me, that tasks that pile up and never get done, would be at that time when I would have a client come in to work with me, and then I would go over, I'd work more on them than I promised. Say their appointment was from 1 to 2 and I'd work with them until 2:20. Then my next appointment's at 2:30, so I only have 5 or 10 minutes to get a drink, go to the bathroom, come back and work again. And it goes on and on and on all day. And then whatever it was that I promised these folks in our time together, I didn't get to because I was overbooked. So completing my work was piling up and I was having to do it at night and on the weekends. Paying my bills. I didn't have an organized system for paying my bills back then. I didn't have any system for doing reading for pleasure, writing for pleasure, or any kind of relaxation. And then this might seem funny to you, but this is interesting. You know, when you have two growing boys in the house, I always had charity donations, clothes that they grew out of, sports equipment, toys, electronic games. And I would put them, you know, on my cleaning frenzies, I would put them in bags and I would intend to take them to the charity. And, you know, dust would be on them because I never did it. So what I started doing was these things that never got done, I started putting them into the calendar and blocking time to do them. I learned this in one of my mastermind groups. I think I knew this, I knew about this concept before, but I was in a mastermind group, another very pivotal moment in my life during this time. And my friend Beverly said to me, why don't you just block a day to get all your work done? And I was like, but I mean, when people need me, it's embarrassing to think that now. But I started blocking Friday afternoons. And Friday afternoon was the day that I did everything that I didn't get to Monday through Thursday. That was really scary for me to do. And it was really important for me to do. And I have to tell you, I never worked past, I mean, back then I used to work past 10 p.m. I don't even work past 6 p.m. now, okay? Unless there's something that I really want to do, if I'm writing, okay? But completing my client work, I don't do that anymore outside of client hours. Paying my bills, obviously, you know, we have electronic banking now, but back then I had to schedule a time, put it on the calendar to not only pay bills, but to bill my clients. And blocking time for reading, writing, and relaxing, and I'll tell you what I did. You guys know already that I own my own business, and I didn't block vacation time. And what I started doing that year that I got sick was I went through the calendar, and every week that had a every month that had a 5-week month in it, I blocked off a week. Sometimes I blocked off a whole week in that 5-week month, and sometimes I blocked off 5 days to do nothing but whatever I wanted. Okay. And whenever I get those yearnings to be like, go to lunch with a friend or take my mom somewhere, I can look on my calendar and see within the next couple of weeks, I have a free day blocked. Okay. And charity donations, you guys, I love giving to charity. I love supporting charities. And I don't like to do that reactively, like by writing a check. So I'm very intentional about that. And so if I gather up a box of something, or if I do a fundraiser, which I'm about to launch one now for a woman who's starting a new life, I'll be really intentional about that. And I'll put it onto my calendar. This is the day that we're going to do this for this charity. That makes me happy. And not burned out. So calendarize the things that are not happening and the things that are important to you. And that's another thing too. This used to stress me out, of course, when the kids were little. But you know, getting all the invitations. This year, it was a lot of high school and college graduations. I had a couple of weddings this year. I had a couple of baby showers this year. That's a lot. And so like scheduling that into my calendar, if that seems silly to you, especially if you're super organized, but I would find myself frantic getting ready to go to a party and stopping at the store to buy gift wrap. You know, I schedule that into my calendar. When I get the invitation, as soon as I get the invitation and it's somebody that I, you know, want to support and want to buy, I have a really cool thing that I do now. We get invited to a lot of college, high school graduations, and a lot of times what the kids do, I like to give gifts. I don't like to give money. I think gifts are more memorable, right? So a lot of times on the invitations, what the parents will do is they'll put, you know, like Susie is going to University of Virginia. And so you see that. So I'll buy them a University of Virginia t-shirt or a notebook or a tote bag, something that that particular kid would like. And I usually buy those on Amazon and I have them gift wrapped on Amazon. So they're here and plenty of time for me to go to that event. But when I get that invitation, I put it on my calendar, buy Susie a gift, University of Virginia. So it's done and I'm not stressed out about it. Okay, how are you guys doing? I'm gonna take a second and come over and see if we have any questions. So a lot more people have joined. Welcome, I'm gonna take a breath here before we get on to the next five. How are you guys feeling? You know what, I have to tell you, I was originally gonna have 10. I'm gonna go to the... Not the questions, where's the chat? I had 10 of these the last time I gave this talk. When I woke up this morning, I was like, you know what? I think I'm gonna cut this down a little bit because I don't wanna go over. And I'm glad I did because I told you guys some stories that I hadn't planned. So, okay. All right, we're gonna move into step 5. Remember, I only have 7 steps, so we're almost there. We're almost there, but hopefully you're feeling motivated and not too overwhelmed. Then hopefully you're feeling a little bit entertained, okay? So step number 5 to being empowered and productive is to optimize your surroundings. So this is a very neat desk. This is not my desk. This is a picture that I got off of a stock photography, but it's not that different than my desk. I like to surround myself. I like to have an environment that is really peaceful to me. And so you can see a little bit of my office now. I have a candle over here. I have aromatherapy. I have my books around me and things that make me feel supported. It's really important that this room that I work in be light and bright and cheerful. I do have flowers and plants in here. It's not a super clean desktop, but it's not a crazy chaotic desktop. But I find like I get a little bit uncomfortable in a sterile environment. So you want to optimize your environment to what really makes sense for you. And so what's most important for optimizing your environment is to mainly remove clutter. Clutter does not help us. It's okay if we have a pile of things that we need to do, but we have piles and piles of things that needed to be done long time ago and just decisions need to be made on, that's overwhelming for us and it's hard for us to function in. So you want to remove, first of all, physical clutter, and second of all, this mental clutter. It's really important. That circle of, am I going to remember? Should I? Shouldn't I? Did I? Didn't I? Did I remember? Did I forget? Who do I think I am? That kind of thing. That's a different class. But you want to really be aware of physical and mental clutter. And when I go into companies that have really big problems with conflict and communication and leadership, 100% of the time, they have clutter. Sometimes it's worse than others, but they always have clutter. And clutter is unmade decisions. Clutter equals overwhelm. And you have to, it just equals bad energy. So here's what I think is so interesting though. When I go into these companies that have crazy amounts of clutter, and it's puzzling to me, there's a theme. Printers, people hang on to printers. Printers that you can't even buy ink for anymore, but they won't get rid of their printer, right? And you can turn these in to electronic recyclers and you can get money for them, or you can get money for your charity, but they hang on to their printers, they hang on to papers, they hang on to books, they hang on to musical instruments of their kids. Crazy things that I see that people hang on to, but you know what is interesting? They're not aware of it until I point it out to them. They're so used to being in that environment that they don't even see it. So it takes an outsider to point it out. There's a lot of dust on the pictures in this office, or it doesn't look like you've ever washed these windows in this office, or it doesn't look like anybody's ever swept up in the driveway or the entrance coming in. Nobody's ever, your housekeeper in your office doesn't run the sweeper in the entryway. It's really dirty. They don't even notice it because they come in with their blinders on. They come in, they sit at their desk, and there are piles, and they've always been there. So the same thing with mental clutter. It's been there. It's been our companion forever. We don't even know it's there. So the first step to that is being aware of it. Take a look around your office as if you're a visitor for the first time. Just things need updated. Does some clutter need to be cleared out? So optimizing your environment by removing your physical clutter. Now, another thing that you could do, let's say that you have something that you need to get done, regardless of clutter. When I wrote the book, Smart Leadership, I had a really tight deadline to get that done, and it did not matter what was around me. I made an agreement with myself to write every night between 8 and 10 p.m. I was so overbooked at that time, and I was so behind on my schedule that I said to myself, I'm writing from 8 to 10 p.m. no matter what happens. And at 8 o'clock, no matter what was going on, I'm not accepting distractions right now. I can't hear you. I can't see you. I'm not talking to my children, but just talking to all the elements that come in. And there were times during that 2-week time period that my desk was completely clean and optimized with my candle burning, my hot drink, my cold drink, everything that I wanted. And there were other times when I set that laptop right on top of a pile of papers and did it anyway. So there's sometimes you have to get real with yourself. I'm not accepting distractions. Now, here's something that doesn't work. Being military-like with yourself and being very rigid with yourself and very strict with yourself, those kind of rules do not work. And I'm talking about like every day between 5 a.m. and 6 a.m., I'm going to blank, you know, run 3 miles or clean the house or read the Bible or whatever you think it is that you should be doing, right? Those kind of things don't work. I mean, you can beat yourself up and do that for a little while, but you're not gonna be thoroughly happy by making yourself be military-like. So think about what's working, think about what's not working, make a list of how you're gonna change it, put it on your calendar and implement it, okay? And if possible, in an optimal solution. All right, I do still have two more strategies for you, but I want to make an announcement right now about something new. So you have probably known me, if you've known me for any part of time, for my Success Academy, my Leadership Academy for Women, and my Success Circle coaching that I do for women. And I've been doing that for the past few years and helping women and men be better leaders, be better business owners, and improve themselves with productivity, with strategies, with systems in their business. My specialty is I help women leaders who want to stand out at work. And I also help women entrepreneurs who are making a few $100s a month in their business and helping them to implement routines that work for them so that they can make a few $1,000s a month in their business. That's really where my sweet spot is. My passion is helping business women and men succeed. And I've been doing that for years with individual coaching and consulting sort of sporadically from here to there. And as things have been changing and becoming more systemized in my life, I've started something new. Now, my success circle was awesome. And I did 5 success circles. I did 5 leadership academies. And I did one-on-one coaching. And I want you to meet somebody that I did coach one-on-one that worked really well. I worked with Tracy Yachts. She's a naturopath. She works in Harmony, Pennsylvania. She also has an office in Pittsburgh. And Tracy and I worked as a coach together for about a year. Once a month, I would go up to her office. She would tell me what her issues were. I'd give her solutions. We did some great work together. And Tracy said that her work with me totally transformed her business. We updated her brand. We redid her website. For Tracy, I think a really important thing that we did was we created packages for her instead of hourly. Here's an hour and here's what you get. We created packages, which was awesome. We also started her with monthly workshops. We did great work together. And last year, Tracy found out when she did her taxes that her business tripled because we implemented some really great systems. And that was really great. But I felt like us working every month, we would like lose momentum in between the time that I wasn't there. But I was traveling a lot. Tracy's business was growing. It worked okay. But I was thinking about how could this be better? And I created the Shift program. Now, how did I come up with the name Shifts? I didn't come up with that name sitting behind my desk, let me tell you. I was driving in my car and I was thinking about this coaching program that I wanted to do. And it's a combination of Leadership Academy and Success Academy and Success Circle and all of my coaching all in one. And I thought, I don't know what I'm gonna call this. And I noticed on my table, I was driving in the car and my books were sitting on the seat, and I was looking at my 2 books, and I noticed, totally on plan, this book is called Smart Leadership, 12 Simple Strategies to Help You Shift from Ineffective Boss to Brilliant Leader. And this one is from Frantic to Focused, How to Shift Your Life from Out of Control to Streamlined and Successful. And I thought, oh, I seem to think I like that word. And it really is beautiful because it's what I do with my clients, whether they're leaders or whether they're entrepreneurs. And so that's where the Shift program created. I have to tell you, I never get a wonderful idea when I'm sitting at my desk. Do you? We have to get away from our desk. So I created the Shift program, How to Stand Out, Be Seen, and Grow Your Business with Integrity. I started doing this spring. And we've had about 6 women come through. Kitsy Higgins was one of my first. And Kitsy has already had a very successful business, but she wanted to make some big shifts. She wanted to shake off some of the things that she'd been doing for years and years and grow into something really new. And I encourage you to go find her on Facebook and follow her. She's going to be doing transformational coaching. She has a fantastic retreat that she's hosting in August. I have just been delighted to work with her. She is the most beautiful energy. And Kitsy says, coaching was both the best and worst thing I've done for my business. What? The best thing is hiring Beth Caldwell. The worst thing is that I waited 5 years to do it. I was so touched when she said that to me on the phone, I got choked up. Because for me, this is what I do every day and I forget how much I've learned. Barb Novat is another one of my first Shift clients, and Barb is so exciting to work with. Whenever I have a session with her, she is implementing as soon as we hang up the phone. And friends, that did not happen when I was coming to see people once a month. But now that we have the Shift program and she knows she's going to be seeing me in about a week or two, my clients are now motivated to do their work. And Barb is a coach who helps families with children with ADHD. And she helps them with everything from daily life management and getting that homework done to negotiating at IEP meetings. She's amazing. She has personal experience from this and she's just tremendous at it. And we've been able to wrap up her experience and her gift of raising 2 boys with ADHD and turn it into a service. And she says that Shift has been an amazing experience. Barb had an idea when we started, and now she has a business, okay? And she says that I helped her with the step-by-step way to get this going. So Shift is a little bit different than one-on-one coaching. We have 6 strategic sessions. Now, for those of you who don't own your own business, the sessions are a little bit different. We do 6 sections on you and positioning you and your company for success. For those of you who own your own business, it's about getting your paycheck up to several thousand dollars a month, or getting you from a few clients to booked full with a waiting list. So there are 6 strategic sessions that we do in less than 12 weeks so that you get accomplished, you get things done, and there's not just a little bit of action and then a downtime and a little bit of action and a downtime. So that is what the shift program is. If you think that that's something for you, if you're ready to shift, I'm going to be sending you an email in just a few minutes, and you can click on that email and we can check it out. We can get to know each other. We'll have a 20-minute coaching session, a mini coaching session, where you can bring to me any problem that you have in your life or business. I'll give you advice on how to fix it. And you know what? I'm not the coach for everybody. I move really, really fast. I have tons of ideas. I love to laugh. You have to record our sessions. We do video sessions like this when we coach, and they have to be recorded because I get so excited about your business that I talk really, really fast. And sometimes you have to go back and listen to it over and over again. And that's not for everybody. And I totally get that. But if that's something that appeals to you, click on that email so we can have a mini session together and see if it's a good fit. It's completely free, no obligation, no pressure at all. I'd love to help you with whatever it is that you need a challenge on. Okay, so if you're ready to shift, click that email and let's get back to our productivity workshop. So far we've done 5 steps. We have 2 more. Number 1 was clear your mind with that brain dump. Number 2 was categorize your to-do list, prioritize it, put it in your calendar, and then optimize your space, okay? Step number 6, really important, stop shooting yourself. I should be doing this. I should be doing that. I should, I could, I didn't, I can't, I haven't, I forgot, whatever it is. I want you to start focusing on what you have done and what you are doing. Yes, I have 22 things on my to-do list, but I did 6 of them today. For years, I focused on what I didn't do. And you know what? I didn't sleep well. I worried. I beat myself up. What people say to me, is there anything you would change about your life? That is the one thing I would change about my life, is how hard I was on myself, okay? And another thing, I'll put this into step number 6, because I'm not going to add another one, is stop making your choices based on what you think other people think. Like, I shouldn't ask for a promotion because that would make my coworkers uncomfortable. Or I want to change my relationship or change my job, but my mother would really hate that. I really don't want to hear that. Stop making those decisions on what you think you should do or what you think other people should do. And maybe I'll do a whole 1-hour workshop on just this. This is really important. And how do you stop shooting yourself? It's the same thing with clutter. Most of the time, we're not even aware we're doing it. And so the first step is being aware. Notice when you have that loop of criticizing yourself and comparing yourself. And you know what it is, you do it. Women have a talent of having that circle go around in their head constantly about the things that they should or should not be doing, okay? So once noticing that chatter and replacing it with positive chatter, and then noticing that you're doing it again. And the more you notice it, you'll start to replace it with positive chatter. Well, yes, I didn't do this, but I did do this. Then as you get into the habit of doing that, you'll begin to catch those thoughts before you even have them. It's a process, but it's definitely something that you can do. If I can do it, I know you can do it. All right, now step number 7 is visualize. Now, this is a gift that I have. I can sit with a client and I can visualize amazing things for them, okay? When I see you and your potential, I don't see any reason why you can't reach your potential. I'm not in your head. I'm not hearing all those things of you're not good enough, you're not certified, you're not qualified, you're not blah, 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 all those things that you say to yourself. I just see your pure potential. That's what I see. And I can help visualize that for you. But you know what? You don't need me, because you get ideas in your head all the time. And you look just like this lady. You know what would be a great idea? You have that idea. And then you tell yourself 10 reasons why you can't do it. So I want you to stop thinking about why you can't do it and start thinking about how amazing it would be if you can do it. Okay? There's so much more I can tell you about this, but I'm just going to give you that little drip for now. Visualize and believe that you can accomplish it. I believe in your unlimited potential. If you need a little bit of help seeing your potential, I encourage you to book that call with me. All right, so let's do a review. We talked about, for empowered productivity, clearing your mind, categorizing your to-do list, prioritizing, calendarizing, making your beautiful space, stop shooting yourself. And I'll change number 7. I want you to visualize your potential, but I want you to believe. Cross that out on your notes and put believe I can do it. To me, that's the most important part of your empowerment and of your success. So you remember earlier I talked about gratitude? I think what year was that? 2013? I think that was 2013. I was asked to participate in a gratitude book. It was called 365 Days of Gratitude. And I thought it was really cool. And I'm a writer. I write articles, right? I thought I could do this. So what is this? I don't know. Probably not even 300 words. It might be 350 words. And I wrote this over Memorial Day weekend. I wrote it over Labor Day weekend. It was a 3-day weekend because I think it had to be into the editor like by September 15th because it was on the newsstands. It was like in the bookstores for Thanksgiving for the next year. You guys, this was the hardest thing I ever wrote. I had such a hard time getting started with this one. And I remember what I did was I went on YouTube and I searched for songs about gratitude to like get me motivated to write this. I could not believe this was a deadline I was having trouble with. And I know it's one of the most important things, the most significant experiences that I've gone through was the process of reviewing my life up to that moment and showing gratitude for it. So I want to give you this excerpt. I can't give it to you in a webinar though. So if you belong to my Facebook group, for Frantic to Focused, or if you follow my page, I'm going to post this on there as a JPEG that you can download and you can have at your desk. If you're not on Facebook, then you're getting emails from me with the reminders for this class and the recording. Just send me an email back and say, can you send me the gratitude excerpts? And I'll send it to you in an email. But it will be on Facebook today. So I want to thank you for joining me today, and I want to encourage you to stay connected with me. My book is From Frantic to Focused. It's on Amazon. It's in all the bookstores. I still do travel around and do For Frantic to Focus workshops. If you'd like me to come to your town, send me an email. I might come and visit you. You can follow me on all the social media channels. And of course, I just mentioned my group on Facebook where I share nothing but happy thoughts and inspiration from Frantic to Focused. So check your email. As soon as we're finished here, you're going to receive a link where you can schedule an appointment with me for a free coaching session where I can help you with some challenge that you're having and we can get to know each other. I want to thank you so much for being here with me today. I'm going to stop the recording and answer the questions. So let's see here. There we go.